Amelia Earhart was one of the most celebrated aviators of her time, a pioneer who broke many records and inspired millions. In this video, we'll explore her life and achievements, as well as the theories and evidence surrounding her final flight and her fate. Facts First presents, Scientists Finally Solve the Mystery of Amelia Earhart. Amelia Mary Earhart was born on the 24th of July, 1897, in Atchison, Kansas. Her father, Edwin, was a lawyer who worked for the railroad, and her mother, Amy, came from a wealthy family. Amelia had a younger sister named Muriel. Growing up, the two kids had all sorts of fun adventures together. They collected insects and frogs, climbed trees, and hunted rats with a rifle. They also read books about heroes and explorers. Amelia wasn't interested in dolls or dresses. Rather, she preferred to wear pants and play sports. She showed an early fascination with machines and technology. She took an auto repair course, learned how to use a camera, and built her own roller coaster in her backyard with the help of her uncle. She was not a very good student, as she often skipped classes and got into trouble. She also had a strong sense of justice and compassion. During World War I, she served as a Red Cross nurse's aide in Toronto, Canada, where she tended to wounded soldiers. It was there that she saw her first airplane at an air show. After the war, Amelia returned to the U.S. and enrolled at Columbia University to study medicine. But she soon dropped out and moved to California with her parents. In 1920, she took her first flight lesson with female pilot Anita Snook at Kinner Field near Long Beach. She was hooked on flying immediately, and in 1921, she bought her first plane. It was a bright yellow Kinner Airster biplane that she nicknamed the Canary. In 1922, Amelia made headlines when she became the first woman ever to fly solo above 14,000 feet. She broke several other records for speed, distance, altitude, and endurance. In 1928, Amelia received an offer from publisher George P. Putnam to join pilot Wilmer Stultz and mechanic Lewis Gordon on a transatlantic flight. The flight would make her the first woman to cross the Atlantic Ocean by plane. Although Amelia didn't pilot the plane herself, she kept track of things like their position, weather conditions, and fuel consumption. The flight took off from Trepassey Harbor, Newfoundland, on June 17, 1928, and landed at Bury Port, Wales, after more than 20 hours of flying. Owing to her unprecedented accomplishment, the flight made Amelia an international celebrity. She received honors from President Calvin Coolidge and King George V, and she went on to write a best-selling book about her experience called 20 Hours, 40 Minutes. She married George Putnam in 1931. Putnam became her manager and promoter. He helped her secure endorsements, lectures, and published articles, and he also supported her flying career. Amelia continued to break records and make history. In 1932, she became the first woman and second person after Charles Lindbergh to fly solo across the Atlantic Ocean. She then became the first person to fly solo across the Pacific Ocean from Honolulu, Hawaii to Oakland, California. And she continued to set new records for speed and distance with each flight. Earhart became a role model and inspiration for many women and girls who wanted to pursue their dream. Her final flight. In 1937, Amelia decided to attempt her most ambitious and dangerous flight yet, a circumnavigation of the globe at its widest point near the equator. She planned to fly a Lockheed Electra 10E plane with navigator Fred Noonan. The flight would cover about 29,000 miles and take about 40 days. Amelia hoped this flight would prove women could do anything men could do. The flight began June 1, 1937 from Miami. Amelia and Fred flew eastward across South America, Africa, India, South Asia, and Australia. They faced many challenges like bad weather, mechanical problems, and navigational errors. But they also received support and encouragement from locals and officials who welcomed them warmly. On July 2, 1937, Amelia and Fred took off from Lae, Papua New Guinea, en route to their next destination, Howland Island, a tiny speck of land in the Central Pacific. It was one of the most challenging legs of the journey because they had to fly over vast stretches of open water with no landmarks or radio stations to guide them, and they had limited fuel and time. Tragically, they never made it to Howland Island. They disappeared somewhere over the Pacific without a trace. No one knows for sure what happened or where they ended up. There are many theories and speculations, but none have been proven conclusively. Some believe they ran out of fuel and crashed into the ocean. Others think they landed on an uninhabited island or reef and died there. Some have even suggested they were captured by Japanese forces who occupied some islands in the area at that time. The most wild theory is the claim they survived and lived under different identities. But newly uncovered scientific evidence just might shed some light on what happened. Exciting new clues have emerged. Scientists specializing in forensic analysis have recently made an intriguing discovery potentially related to Amelia's disappearance. An aluminum panel recovered from a remote island in 1991, near the location where Earhart's plane went missing, was found to have letters and numbers etched on it. The markings, including D24, XRO, and either 335 or 385, suggest the panel may have been part of a repair, as it shows signs of corrosion and rivet punctures similar to Earhart's Lockheed Electra plane, though not an exact match. The scientists are currently investigating the origins of these markings, which could be related to manufacturing codes. If they can confirm the panel belongs to Earhart's plane, it would help dispel some of the more outlandish theories surrounding her disappearance. It would also confirm that Earhart indeed made it to Nikumaroro and later died there. Her remains were possibly discovered. According to a researcher from the University of Tennessee, bone measurements suggest that remains found on the remote South Pacific island are likely those of the famous American pilot. Professor Richard Jantz re-examined measurements conducted in 1940 by physician D.W. Hoodless, who had concluded that the bones discovered belonged to a man. Mysteriously, the bones eventually disappeared, so all that Professor Jantz was able to work with was metric data limited to 4 measurements of the deceased skull and 3 other bones. But he used modern techniques, including a computer program called Fordisk, and found that Hoodless had incorrectly determined the sex of the remains. Jantz further compared the bone lengths with Earhart's measurements and made the determination that the bones were likely hers. Interestingly, when the bones were initially discovered in 1940, the search party also found part of a shoe deemed to have belonged to a woman. They also found a sextant box designed to house a Brandis Navy surveying sextant, similar to one that Earhart's co-pilot used. Jantz investigated other theories about the bones as well. He looked into the possibility they could have belonged to any one of 11 men presumably killed in a 1929 shipwreck near Nikumaroro's western reef, about 4 miles away. He also entertained the idea that the remains possibly belonged to a Pacific Islander. But he concluded there wasn't any documentation on the men that went missing, nor evidence that they could have survived the shipwreck and died as unlucky castaways. Plus, the shoe and box found were not consistent with either of the 2 alternate theories. Based on the information available, Jantz concluded the remains found on the island were more than likely those of Earhart. The study was published in the journal Forensic Anthropology. Now it's time to hear from you. What do you think really happened to Amelia Earhart? Let us know in the comments section below.